Penguin Random House Audio presents One Day Smarter, hilarious random information to uplift and inspire. This is the author, Emily Winter. Note to listeners, this program includes a downloadable PDF that contains trivia games and answers from the book. Introduction. Never stop learning, because when you stop learning, you stop growing. Those were the words of the scuba dive master who certified me for the sport when I was 12. That was a long time ago, but I remember his advice exactly. For years, I ruminated on it. I journaled about it. It stuck with me because it was so simple, yet so profound. And the dive master was hot. Even though that dive master is now approximately 1,000 years old and seemingly off social media, what? A good writer always does her research. I still keep his words in my mind. They've helped me often throughout my career as a writer and a comedian. There's always more to learn, more to discover, new metaphorical mountains to climb. Admittedly, sometimes thinking about the inexhaustible amount of information in the world stresses me out, but more often it makes me feel excited, determined, and energized. I'm lucky to work in a field that encourages fresh ideas. Stand-up comedy, in fact, demands it. And as a game and joke writer for the NPR trivia show Ask Me Another, I'm constantly going down encyclopedic rabbit holes in search of fascinating, oft-forgotten tidbits. I'm very excited about this book, and grateful to be researching uplifting facts during turbulent times. So often, it seems as though all the news, all the history, all the information is negative. And when it feels like I'm trapped in a tumble dryer with only bad news, I get depressed and panicked, stuck in an unproductive, unhealthy combination of anxious paralysis. In short, I become a quivering puddle person, and I wonder if there's any good left in the world. But today I'm happy to report there is. In my research, I've discovered that there's kindness, beauty, empathy, humor, resilience, wonder, silliness, cuteness, strength, hope, and joy in our world. Thank friggin' goodness. And thank you. Thank you for considering listening to this book of my favorite trivia, as well as cherished facts from bona fide experts and the smarty pants who walk among us, former Jeopardy contestants. My aims for this project are twofold: to make you one day smarter every time you visit it, and to light up your brain in a positive way. While we can't and shouldn't ignore all the problems in our world, it's also helpful, calming, inspirational, and necessary to learn about the good stuff, too. I think we could all use a little good stuff right now. On Failure and Rejection. I thought this was a book of uplifting trivia, you may be saying out loud to your cat who's ignoring you. It is. Truly, what's more comforting than realizing even your heroes have been rejected? Literally, all of us are failures, and internalizing that fact makes future rejections less scary and painful. This chapter is particularly dear to my heart. A few years ago, after a stinging job rejection, I set out to collect 100 professional failures as my New Year's resolution. Did I get 100? No, I got 107. I wrote about my failure project for the New York Times and even got to appear on the Today Show. Now I get to write this book for you, a task I consider a dream job. So even though I've collected more rejections than anyone I know, I'm not embarrassed because my life and career are better off for them. I know I'll face heaps of no's in the future, but with all of those rejections comes the odd, glorious acceptance. And every time I fail, I can think about one of these comforting facts. Peanuts creator Charles Schulz's drawings were rejected by his high school yearbook. Oprah Winfrey was fired from her first job as a news anchor in Baltimore for getting too emotionally invested in her work. Gisele Bündchen was rejected by 42 modeling agencies before her career finally took off. Tyra Banks was rejected by 6. It took Sir James Dyson 15 years and 5,126 unsuccessful prototypes before he nailed his Dyson vacuum. Today, he's worth an estimated $9.7 billion. Both HBO and Showtime passed on Mad Men before AMC scooped it up. E.E. Cummings wrote a book of poetry titled No Thanks, dedicated to the 14 publishers that rejected him. Steven Spielberg was rejected from the University of Southern California and its prestigious film school 3 times. Elvis failed high school music class. In 2012, Uzo Aduba hit rock bottom, crying her way home from yet another audition and deciding it might be time for her plan B, law school. 45 minutes later, she was offered the role of Suzanne on Orange is the New Black, for which she later won an Emmy. Shakira was cut from her grade school choir, and peers made fun of her for sounding like a goat. Einstein didn't speak until he was 4 and didn't speak fluently until he was 9. Lady Gaga, Destiny's Child, Bruno Mars, and Katy Perry have all been dropped by a record label. Of Emily Dickinson's more than 1,800 poems, only 10 were published in her lifetime. Now there's an entire museum dedicated to her work. Before getting cast as the star of Homeland, Claire Danes hadn't booked a role for 2 years. She almost gave up acting to become an interior designer. When President Ulysses S. Grant was a kid, his father nicknamed him Useless. After an audition, a casting director told Sidney Poitier he should stop wasting people's time and become a dishwasher. Poitier later became the first Black man to win an Oscar for Best Actor. Vera Wang didn't make the 1968 Olympic figure skating team and later didn't get the job as Vogue's editor-in-chief. It wasn't until she was in her 40s that she began designing wedding gowns and became a world-renowned fashion designer. Can't act, can't sing, balding, can dance a little. Those were the notes about an early screen test of Fred Astaire, who's now regarded as one of the best dancers ever to appear on film. Get rejected from Harvard? If you aren't a legacy, don't feel bad. 29% of 2019 Harvard freshmen were relatives of Harvard grads. Get rejected from working at Walmart? Well, the superstore accepts even fewer applicants than Harvard. Walmart takes 2.6% of applicants. Harvard accepts 4.5%. Before he was president, Thomas Jefferson anonymously submitted an architectural design for the White House. It was rejected. In 1851, Herman Melville received a rejection letter for Moby Dick that read, "First, we must ask, does it have to be a whale? While this is a rather delightful, if somewhat esoteric, plot device, we recommend an antagonist with a more popular visage among the younger readers. For instance, could not the captain be struggling with a depravity toward young, perhaps voluptuous maidens?" If you've ever failed at a New Year's resolution, don't feel inferior to your fellow Earthmates. Only 8% of people achieve their resolution goals by the following year. The Beatles were told that they had no future in show business when they auditioned for a major record label called Decca Records in 1962, just under 2 years before their breakout. Before getting cast as Alexis Rose on Schitt's Creek, Annie Murphy hadn't landed a role in nearly 2 years, her apartment burned down, and she had $3 in her bank account. Stephen King's Carrie was rejected by 30 publishers before King literally threw it in the garbage. His wife Tabitha fished it out and convinced him to resubmit it. Finally, it was accepted by Doubleday, and it went on to sell more than 4 million copies. Successful people are better liked when they talk about their failures in addition to their achievements. Music. This chapter goes out to everyone who, like me, has tried but failed to unleash their inner musical goddess. As a kid, I disappointed several piano teachers and flubbed every recital. In college, my drum teacher told me it's impossible to teach percussion to a person who has no rhythm. That was harsh, but true. Though I'm a musical potato, I still enjoy the stuff, so I checked in with an expert to give the genre its due. Billboard editor Joe Lynch enlightened me with several of his all-time favorite music facts. Little Richard fired Jimi Hendrix from his band because he upstaged him. Purple Rain was Prince's attempt to write a song in the style of Bob Seger. And singing in a group maintains and even improves mental health. Unless, of course, you're singing with me, in which case you might become depressed, but that's besides the point. The idea of the Song of Summer has been around since the early 1900s. Newspapers wrote about one-hit wonders like 1909.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.